More than conquerors. The book of Joshua that we are reading in January. I trust you are reading, and you can get your life journal for free out in the foyer, in the entranceway, and also the Bible reading plan. We're doing Joshua and Ephesians, and we're linking them together. So it records, the book of Joshua records the possession of the land of Canaan by Israel and the fierce opposition by the local inhabitants to their every forward move. And so there were 32 kings and armies that resisted Joshua and this new generation, because Moses is now dead. Okay, he is gone. The children of Israel were for 400 years, the Hebrew people, slaves in Egypt. Pharaoh was an illustration of the devil and how he wants to oppress and harm God's people. But God raised up a deliverer. His name is not Jesus, he is Moses. He's a Jesus figure. And his birth is quite amazing, how he survived. And he grew up in Pharaoh's home. And God raises him up to deliver the people. So 400 years of slavery. And then for 40 years, from the Nile Delta through to the Jordan Valley, crossing over Sinai, the desert regions. For 40 years they wandered and were very much in a defensive position. And the nation was being formed. They drew up laws and regulations, spiritual laws and social laws. And how do you govern 3 million people on the move? It was an amazing story. You can read it in Exodus and Leviticus, Numbers and Deuteronomy. But now Moses has died and a new generation's been raised up. The leader is Joshua, and he's now facing the River Jordan, and before him is a city with high walls called Jericho. And so now, after 40 years of defensively walking through the wilderness, they're now ready to take offensive action. And it took them around 7 years to conquer the land. And so the book of Joshua, I see it very much linked with the New Testament letter of Ephesians. And as you read the book of Ephesians about who we are in Christ and how we're to walk with Christ and how we're to war with the power of Christ in us and through us, you can see some similarities with Joshua. So I'm linking it together. So the entire Christian life, folks, is about warfare. If you're not a Christian and you're thinking about becoming a Christian, I would be lying to you to say, accept Christ and everything's going to be hunky-dory, everything will go well for you, and there'll never be any trouble. In fact, if you become a Christian, the truth is you're getting enlisted into an army. It's called Jesus Army. And there is an enemy. His name is the devil. And he has followers called demons or evil spirits. And the Christian life is one of warfare. However, some people have said to me, Bill, isn't it unfair that we're fighting an enemy we cannot see? Can't see him. They're persons without bodies. Okay, here in this place today, there are persons without bodies. No demons, just angels looking in. And while we were singing, Laura, and they were watching you and the team, they're looking in and going, what are they so excited about? See, the angels don't get it. They've never sinned. They've never fallen. They don't know what it's like to be lost and broken and alienated. And so they just forever worshipping God and obeying him and doing his will. So they're looking in on us and saying, wow, you guys are really excited. You're really enthused because we were broken. We were lost. We were sinners. We were doing our own thing. We were heading for hell and damnation. And Christ saved us. And so angels are real. But demons are real as well. And so they will endeavor to exploit and oppose Christians, to try and find chinks in their armor. And so it's, in one sense, it's unfair. We fight an enemy we cannot see. But you know what the truth is? It's also unfair in that we fight an enemy that's already defeated. Hey, we can't see him, but he's already defeated through Jesus' life, death, resurrection, and ongoing ministry, the sending of the Holy Spirit. We've already won the victory, just that we don't know it. We don't know it yet, and we've got to actually understand that and grab hold of that and then start to possess the land and push out the enemy who's trying to oppose us. So it's not a fight to defeat the enemy. It's a series of battles to possess the territory that is already ours but is illegally occupied by a defeated enemy. So last Sunday, I shared about getting to know this God of great promises. And this God of great promises, he promised the land to Abraham hundreds of years before Moses and Joshua, and to his son Isaac, and to his son Jacob, and to his sons Joseph and all the others, and to Moses and to Joshua. So for hundreds of years, the promise was given, but they hadn't possessed it yet. It was a concept. It was an idea. It was like we now have been blessed with every spiritual blessing in heavenly realms in Christ. It's a concept. It's a promise. The concept of me sitting with Christ in heavenly places. It means I'm in a position of authority. I'm in a position of rulership. Okay, I've got to get that into my head. But that doesn't mean that the reality has happened. So the promises were given regarding the land for hundreds of years, but they still had not taken one inch of it. But now came the time, this new Joshua generation, they had to possess the land. So today my focus is on moving forward with confident and courageous faith in this miracle working God. Otherwise, it's a theoretical understanding of God. I know who he is. I accept his promises. But those promises, how are they going to be fulfilled unless I move forward with courageous faith? With faith that inherent in it is a confidence that God's going to work some miracles as I move forward. So the Hebrew people not only had to believe the land was theirs, they now had to actually possess it. The promise became a possession only as they placed their feet upon it. Joshua 1:3 says, I will give you, read it with me, I will give you every place you set your foot as I promised Moses. The promise is there, but now you're only going to get the places where you set your foot. They had to do something about the promise. Some action was required. Look at verse 11 of Joshua 1. 3 days from now, Joshua says to the people, you will cross the Jordan here to go in and what? Say it with me. Take possession of the land the Lord your God is giving you for your own. So revelation and knowledge of our inheritance is one thing, who we are in Christ. And what all the promises of God, that's one thing. Appropriating that inheritance is another. The Hebrew people face that. We face that as believers in Christ. We need to put our faith into action. There are too many Christians just sitting back and singing about victory. In the life to come, maybe. It's going to be better in the future. But who failed to appropriate the victory in the here and now. As I mentioned last week, there is hope in Jesus for all our tomorrows, but there is practical help through Jesus for all our todays. The help that we need. The promises can become a reality in this life through active faith. Active forward-moving faith is required if the promise is going to be possessed. A living faith, hear me on this, cannot be separated from taking some form of practical action. James says this in James 2:17. In the same way, faith by itself, if it is not accompanied by action, is dead as a dodo. 2 Corinthians 5:7. For we walk by faith and not by sight. It's an action word. In fact, the Greek word for faith, we think it's a noun, a non-active word, but the Greek word pistevo, and we anglicize it by saying pisteo, but it's actually pistevo is a verb. It's an action word. It's moving forward. It's not static. It's not holding back, waiting. It's actually moving forward, possessing, taking hold. Saving faith. There are three elements to faith. Now when people talk about faith, sometimes people think, oh, well, it's just Christians and religious people that exercise faith. Hey, listen, you exercise faith coming into this place today. You believed correctly that if you got into your car and drove here, some crazy person who's been drinking all night is not going to bang into you and kill you. Because if you believed that that could happen, you wouldn't get out of your house. Okay? And you think of the serious mental illness of agoraphobia. And I've prayed with people who would not leave their home because their fear has overtaken them and has paralyzed their thinking and their forward movement because they fear all these things could happen. You couldn't live if you didn't operate by faith. When you came in today and sat on the chair, you didn't go, or maybe one of you might have done it if you're a little bit paranoid, and check the seat in case Bill or Nathan or one of the pastors sabotaged it. Maybe we undid the screws. And maybe we kind of set it up so that you sit down and go, boom! Because I have a tip-up chair in my office for people I don't like. I say, come and sit on that chair. And they sit and I go, whoosh, and I go straight back. You believed in me. You believe in the integrity of our pastors, that we didn't booby-trap that chair, didn't you? You didn't think about, oh, I better check the chair. No, you trusted us. You live by faith. Not just by reason. It's reasonable faith. But faith is part of the fabric of our being. How many of you here, and I'm sure there'll be some of you here, that have actually jumped out of an aeroplane with a parachute? Who has done this most foolish of things? Can I see your hands raised? Who has jumped out of a plane? Michael Bonacursa, Malcolm Brown. You guys need prayer afterwards to be delivered of that daring spirit. I think my daughter Nikki and her husband Tim, I think they've done the same too, without me knowing, and they informed me later because I would have locked them in their house and thrown the key away. Parachuting. Now, you guys that did it, okay, a few of you have done it. How many are thinking of doing it? Would like to do it? Kathy, put your hand down straight away. I'll tell you what you won't do. If you think about becoming a skydiver, you're not going to do this. You say, oh, tomorrow I would like to become a skydiver. So tomorrow morning you ring up Parafil, say, is there a plane available? Yeah, there is. Is there a pilot? Yes, he's waiting. Is there a parachute? Yeah, actually, we do have one. Great, I'll be there in an hour. And you go there, and you grab the parachute, you stick it on, pilot, let's get moving. Up you go, 4,000 feet, you're strapped on, you open the door, and you jump out and become a parachutist, a skydiver. That's what you do, isn't that right? If you did that, that is stupid faith. That is presumptuous faith. That is unintelligent faith. That is just dumb, 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 dumb. Now, this is what you should do. First of all, you do a course. Not 3 months, 3 years till you graduate with a PhD in parachuting. You read all the books, you do all the courses, you hear 100 testimonies of people who have done it and no one's had an injury. Okay, you kind of get all the evidence, all the knowledge, information. Okay? And then you come to a place, and then you also check out the manufacturers of the parachute. And if it's a, get German. German made's always the best. It won't break. And if you're like me, I will have one parachute, you know, the spare parachute in case it doesn't, with the first one's work, I'd have two extra ones. Might be big. But so I come to the place after 3 years of intense study, intense reflection, hearing a whole pile of stories, that I actually come to a place of belief. That I believe skydiving is a perfectly safe and legitimate sport. I've received all the information, all the knowledge, and I've done the courses, and I actually now believe, I've heard the stories, that it is a perfectly safe and legitimate sport. So therefore, I'm a skydiver, yes? I'm a believer in skydiving. I'm a skydiver, yes? I'm a believer in skydiving. I have to be. You can be a believer in skydiving and not be a skydiver. Okay, so we get on the plane. Up we go. Goggles are on, helmet. I'm ready. 3,000 or 4,000 feet up. The door opens. I better be careful here. One foot out. Am I a skydiver? But I'm a believer. I've got all the stuff on. Okay, am I a skydiver if I put the parachute on before I jump? No, the plane will go down. You'll kill everyone. You can't do them inside the plane. No, there comes a point, the element that makes the difference is that little word, trust. T-R-U-S-T. I have to trust in the information and the knowledge and the testimonies I've heard that I have believed with my mind. Knowledge, belief. What makes me a skydiver is when I, by sheer trust, abandon myself. Out I go. Heck. And as I go, then I turn on that jolly parachute. I can't turn it on before I trust. See, some people are waiting to get saved until they feel they're saved, until they feel God accepts them, until they feel forgiven. You never will. You've got to trust. You see, you can say, I have all the knowledge about Jesus. You can say, I believe everything Jesus did on the cross to save the world and to forgive the world their sins. But unless you yourself then abandon yourself, rely upon him and say, okay, I give you my sin, and confess with your mouth, Jesus, I have sinned. Confess, I want you as my Lord. And now, Lord, I give you my sin and I receive your forgiveness and the gift of eternal life. I'm stepping out. And it's not just general faith, belief. It's actually trusting faith, relying faith. That makes the difference. That's how you get saved. That's the element of faith. Hey, these days it doesn't happen, but believe it or not, in 1982, as I'm crossing the Pacific Ocean, my first overseas trip, on a big jumbo jet, I asked the girls, what do you call them? Hostesses. I said, is it possible for me to go into the cockpit and to meet the pilots and to see how this thing is being flown? Oh, I'd really love to. And I go, oh, we'll consider it. An hour later, after lunch, or after the meal, middle of crossing over the Pacific, says, sir, come, they're ready for you. Can't do that now, of course. So I walk in, big 747, and this is what I'm thinking. This is what I'm thinking. The pilot would be there like this. The flight engineer would be there watching all the buttons. The co-pilot is there just in case the pilot has a heart attack so he can take over to save my life, to protect me as I'm crossing the Pacific Ocean. That's what the image has. That's a fair image, isn't it? So I walk in and it's coffee break. They're all in a semicircle having a cup of tea, dunking their biscuits in their cup of tea. No one's driving this thing. And I look outside and it's pitch black. I can just hear noise. It's pitch black. I can't tell if we're going up, going down, going sideways. It's just like, and it's just like dark. And I was stunned. Absolutely stunned. I couldn't say anything in that. And I finally got these words out. And I said, oh, it's great to be in here. I said, look, I've always knew that we had to have absolute faith in you as pilots, in your capacity to fly. So I've never doubted that. You know, we know that we have to trust you. I said, but I've just realized now how you guys have to have absolute faith and trust that your instruments are telling you the truth. And they kind of look at me like it's a bit of a profound thought for crossing the Pacific. And I go, yeah. I said, this plane, you're flying it by sheer faith. And they basically said, yeah. Not reason, not senses, not feelings. If they were flying it by senses, reason, feelings, the plane would go down. Because they can't see anything. They can't feel anything. So those men, all men, there were no women there. So I'm saying to them, well, how do you know your instruments are accurate? They give me an answer. I said, and I'm thinking, this is the slightly compulsive, obsessive nature. I said, what happens if there's a power failure? I'm thinking the worst case scenario, like, what happens if there's a power failure in your instrument? And they go, oh, that's fine, we have a backup system. What happens if that backup system fails? Oh, that's fine, you see those three instruments? Each one is individually battery operated. The probabilities of having a power failure, then a second power failure, the backup system, and each battery of every instrument goes, it won't happen. I know, wow, you got everything covered. Yep. See, it's reasonable faith. But they have to believe what their instruments tell them. I've listened to a pilot in a small plane recording his death throes, who's not instrument rated, in a film, it's a fact and faith film. They used to be around, I used to use those films to evangelize in schools. And this poor man in California, he's flying up, okay? It's a bit like John F. Kennedy Jr., he and his wife and wife's sister, as they flew out of New York, 1999, the president's son, hit overcast weather. They were not properly instrument rated. And I'm listening to this pilot as he's radioing down to the control tower saying, I can't see, I don't know where I am. And the guy, cool, calm, collected, says, sir, the radar tells us you are here. I'm not too sure if I'm going, which way am I going? He goes, what does your instrument tell you in the front? It says this, but I think it's, and he's actually arguing with the flight controller because his senses, his ears, his mind, his heart was telling him the opposite because he can't see anything. And I still remember the flight lieutenant, the flight controller saying, sir, what is your instrument saying? It says this, follow your instrument. And the guy didn't follow the instrument, and you hear him, bang, stop getting killed. Because he didn't trust that his instruments were telling him the truth. And he was walking by his feelings. He was flowing by his feelings, by his own reason, by his own senses. You cannot get saved. You cannot stay. You cannot experience assurance of salvation unless that vital element of trust is there. That you trust that God's word is true. That you trust that when he says you're forgiven, that if you confess your sins, 1 John 1:9, if you confess your sins, he is faithful and just and will forgive you your sins and cleanse you from all unrighteousness. See, my senses may doubt that, but if you doubt that, you're really saying, God, you're not faithful, you're not trustworthy. He says, if you confess your sins, if you throw yourself upon me, you will be saved. All your sins will be cancelled out. You'll be forgiven. You'll have assurance of salvation. You'll experience it. The promise becomes a reality. All of God's promises can become a reality in us when we wholeheartedly embrace the God of the promise. Last week we heard Penny Hamble share her story. Wasn't that an amazing story? We're going to hear another story in a few minutes. Penny Hamble's story, if you didn't hear it and you weren't here last Sunday, you can. We're on TV actually. We got our own television station. Do you realise that? It's called YouTube, Christian Family Centre TV. And the message is there. I listened to it this week. I got blessed again by hearing my own message. No, I got blessed by listening to Penny. Wonderful story. You hear her story. What she was. What she became. What was done to her. Vile and wicked things when she's only a little girl. And I remember her as this beautiful woman coming with her husband and she just accepted Christ. And when she told me her story, I thought, I could not believe that such evil could be done to another human being. And as Penny and I were talking, you've got to read the story, her story. We've written it up in the book that I've produced, the Me I Can Be. Her testimony is in the first chapter. We're releasing it on the 1st of February. So you can all purchase one and one for a friend and give it to them. But that story, when I was talking to Penny, she said, it's hard to believe I'm the same person. But she's an example where she knows how broken, how injured, how dysfunctional, how troubled the promises of God came her way, and she believed them. And more than that, she then took those promises, imbibed them, and outworked them in her life. And the person you see is a totally transformed person. Amazing to see that. It's real, it works. That's why got a big story for each of the six chapters in this book so that people can say, okay, I've heard the message now, I'm listening to a testimony. Look, biblical faith is all about depending, relying and cooperating with God. Before you leave today, I've got a gift for you. I love bookmarks. People say people don't use bookmarks today, Bill, but I say, well, I do. I kept every bookmark in my Bible. Do you still have a physical Bible, or do you just use the gadgets? I mean, I use the gadgets too, but there's nothing like holding a Bible. And then I'd out come all my bookmarks. And I've got one of Steph, Nick, Joel and Catherine when they're, you know, pixie photos, you know. And I look at them and go, oh, weren't they beautiful back then? Weren't they nice back then? So they're great. So I've got this that gives you the promises, the great promises of God, how God sees us in Christ. positive promises from God. You can put it up, guys. These are past tense promises to be believed and to be received. And I've listed a whole stack. In fact, in the book, The Me I Can Be, I've got maybe 70, 80 of them listed there. But I've just got a few here that I think are so important. And I gave them I shared them last week. I'm going to go over some of them again now. You know, the biggest problem God has with you is this. You might say, oh, this will be revelation. What's the biggest problem God has with me? You want to know what it is? It's your believing. It's the biggest problem he has with you. And if you look at Jesus, how often he said to his disciples, come on, guys, cut it out. You believe in the wrong things. Believe the right things. Come on, stop fearing. Stop fearing. Trust me. We're going to get to the other side. Just, that demon's not going to kill your daughter. Believe. Trust. Trust in me. So if Jesus got mad with his disciples, and he used to get cross at times, he wouldn't get cross at their stupidity. Sometimes they did some stupid things. But he got cross at their wrong believing because he knew they're going to limit God working in their lives. So oftentimes he told them off, come on, guys, got trust, believe. And when he saw great faith, he just went nuts. He goes, oh, I haven't seen such faith in all of Israel. And you know, the great faith, two times he commended great faith, there were two pagans. One was a Roman centurion, an Italian centurion. The other was a Greek, a Syrian Phoenician woman. Her daughter was bound by an evil spirit. And the disciples, you know, they really couldn't help her. And the Italian centurion had a servant, a slave that got injured. So these are pagans. These are non-Christians, non-Jews. But they come to Jesus and you read the story, how they interacted with him. He goes, man, that is fantastic. I haven't seen such faith in all of Israel. Go your way. Your servant is healed. Oh, the centurion goes, oh, no, you come. I don't need to come. Just go. According to your faith, so be it to you. And he got thrilled. You could see Jesus rejoicing. And one time with the disciples, they're trying to cast out an evil spirit and they're struggling. And Jesus says, oh, for goodness sake, you guys, how long do I have to be with you? You can't deal with this thing. Bring the boy to me. He brings the boy and he deals with that demon, casts it out, and he gets healed and he tells off his disciples. He's frustrated. Come on. How long do I have to be with you? Can't you see how I move in faith? It's not just the promise, it's actually acting and believing that God will support you. He will work with you. These are how God sees us in Christ. Now, these are past tense promises to be believed and received. However, my message today is on faith. So what I've done, and I haven't put them on here, this is just the promises. I've taken the book of Ephesians, the six chapters, I thought, because I'm linking it with Joshua, and I'm actually linking the promise with a faith action step. How God outworks the promises, some positive faith actions. Now, if some of you are really keen, you can email Nathan Betcher and he can email these to you, okay? And is that okay, Nathan? An extra job? 500 people might contact you this week, that's okay. In fact, this could be another bookmark, but it'd be a long bookmark. How God outworks the promises, some positive faith actions. But notice, it's not past tense promises to be believed and received. Present tense appropriation. It requires action on your part. It requires movement, acting upon the promises we have received. Let's read some of them. I'll do them quick. I am forgiven and cleansed from sin, the promise. Therefore, the action. Promise, now the action. Okay, turning, it says, therefore, be kind and compassionate to one another, forgiving each other, just as in Christ God forgave you. How do you outwork this practically? Because if you're forgiven and cleansed, you cannot hold on to grudges with other people. So I love the story of President Ronald Reagan when he got shot by that crazy boy, John Hinckley Jr. Shoots him. Shot three or four people and the bullet ricocheted off the Secret Service guys. Amazing. You check it out on YouTube. These guys are amazing. One guy stands in the road to take the bullet for the president. Just jumps in, just stands there to take it. And the other guy pushes him into the car, and the bullet would have gone probably into his head, and the bullet ricocheted off the limousine and went under his armpit. Choo, was straight right next to his heart. Secret Service guys jumped on top of him, and the president's going, "You're killing me, I'm in pain." And the guy's ripping the president's clothes off, and he's feeling everywhere, any holes, can't find anything. And then the president starts spitting out blood. He says, "Driver, straight to the hospital." Boom, they take off, and he nearly died. And he said to his daughter these words, 70 years of age. He said these words. Patty Reagan said this: "The following day, my father said he knew his physical healing was directly dependent on his ability to forgive John Hinckley Jr." Reagan's own words says this: "By showing me that forgiveness is the key to everything," this is Jesus, "including physical health and healing, he gave me an example of Christ-like thinking." Reagan says that his amazing recovery was linked that from the day one he forgave his potential murderer. Didn't agree with him, didn't pardon him, but agreed to forgive him and not to hold on to resentment. Cool, powerful, that's action. "I am forgiven and cleansed, therefore what will you do to outwork it? I am without blemish, free from accusation," Colossians 1:22. Your mind's got to catch up with God's promises. That's why, therefore, in Ephesians, be made new in the attitude of your minds. You've got to get your subconscious mind reprogrammed. I have a whole chapter on this in the book, The Me I Can Be, to affirm how adequate you now are in Christ. You are adequate in him. You're without blemish and free from accusation. You heard the story of the two cows that were grazing in a pasture when they saw the milk truck pass by? Anyone heard that story? Okay, someone at the back has. Well, on the side of the truck were the words pasteurized, homogenized, vitamins added. And one cow goes, "Shh." Said the other cow, "Makes you sort of feel a bit inadequate, doesn't it?" Hey, we don't have to be homogenized, pasteurized, things added to us. We are without blemish and free from accusation. The milk is pure. You are pure and holy before God. Nothing you can do can change that. But your mind will fight that because you will see your past sins. You remember them. You will see your present failings. And you'll listen to the devil's lies saying, "Oh, no, not much has changed. You see, you still think this way, or you still made this mistake." No, 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 no. The change will come when you start agreeing with God. Be made new in the attitude of your mind. Reprogram your subconscious, agree with God. Got to do something about it. It's faith for the promise to become a reality. "I have been delivered and set free from the old life," Colossians 1:13. "Therefore," I love this one, "in your anger, do not sin. Do not let the sun go down while you're still angry, and do not give the devil a foothold." You can say you've been delivered from the old life, but how do you handle anger? Here he says, okay, make sure you're angry, but don't sin. And then when the sun goes down, get rid of the anger. Practical. Don't hold on to it for 2 days, 3 days, 3 months, 3 years, as some people do, and it eats away at the fabric of their life. "I'm a new creation. Therefore, I tell you this and insist on it in the Lord that you must no longer live as Gentiles do." In other words, read Ephesians and to see what Paul describes as futile thinking. In the futility of their thinking. So to be a new creation, you've got to get rid of futile thinking and look at what Christian thinking and behavior is. "I am a child of God. Therefore," he says, "be imitators of God as dearly loved children." In other words, emulate Jesus. If you're going to imitate Jesus, read the four Gospels, follow his example and of what it means to be a child of God. "I'm accepted by God. Therefore, be completely humble and gentle, be patient, bearing with one another in love." That's what we've got to do. See, accepting others in spite of differences is a good measure of how deeply we appreciate and have appropriated this promise of faith. If you're no longer accepting, if you don't accept people, you're always judging them and condemning them and not accepting that people are different. Because how the heck can you experience fully the full acceptance by God of yourself? We are accepted, so therefore, that's why we've got to humble ourselves. "I'm made righteous. Therefore, you're once darkness, but now you are light in the Lord. Live as children of light." For the fruit of light consists in all goodness, righteousness, and truth. In other words, choose to reflect this new right standing by living with integrity among all people. So you can say, I have a right standing with God. That's a promise. I'm made righteous. Now, as you outwork it, your position in Him, as you step out, His power will help you to actually live a righteous life. I am God's workmanship. Therefore, have nothing to do with fruitless deeds of darkness, but rather expose them. Choose to reject some things that are opposed to what Jesus expects of people. That's a faith action. I am complete in Christ. Colossians 2:10. And he goes, okay, now pray that you get rooted and established in love. In other words, let Jesus make His home in you. May have power together with all the Lord's holy people to grasp how wide and long and high and deep is the love of Christ, and to know this love that surpasses knowledge, that you may be filled to the measure of the fullness of God. So he says, I'm complete in Christ, but how do you get to the fullness of God? Is by becoming more loving, becoming more aware of God's love for you, and then practicing that with among the community of Christian people, that the promise is realized. I'm enthroned with Christ. I love this one. Therefore, in Him and through faith in Him, we may approach God with freedom and confidence. So let your prayers be prayers of confidence, prayers of faith, because now you're enthroned with Him. I reign in life. I love this. Always giving thanks to God the Father. See, if you're reigning in life, no matter what happens, no matter what circumstances come your way, you don't give God thanks for the circumstance. You give God thanks that He is still in control, and in spite of the circumstances, I'm going to give thanks. I'm reigning in life. I'm viewing life from the throne room. I'm not looking up. So I'm thankful. Thankful to God for the blessings. I'm not looking at what I don't have. I look at what I do have. I was watching a YouTube clip of the great Roy Orbison, who I think is probably the greatest singer of the 1960s. Wonderful singer. I saw him when I was a kid. And I loved him as a child, and I love his music. I never realised he was a Christian. I never realised that. And he openly testifies. And that's why he never sang trashy songs, nor always wrote these beautiful songs with magnificent words. But his wife gets killed while they're on the motorbike. 1966. They're riding the bike and the guy comes out, bang, dead, instant. He packs up, doesn't know exactly what to do. He stops writing music and he does a tour. He's at 1968 in the UK, and he meets this woman who becomes the new love of his life. He marries her later. And while he's over there, his two boys out of three boys got burnt to death in a house fire. Man! 2 years later, three beautiful boys and two of them burnt to death. And everyone said, oh, that's it. You know, Orbison's finished. He's gone. And Johnny Cash, who was living in the neighbourhood, Johnny, of course, had become a Christian. Johnny and him became best friends and they lived together. And Johnny shares the story. And I never hear the great Roy Orbison. They said, how did you cope with that? He goes, well, because I'm a Christian. Up front. He goes, it was God's word and God's people that helped me because I needed help. And God provided a wonderful new wife, and I've got two more kids, produced two more kids. And they're all singers now. They carry on the tradition. And one of the comments he made was, and I said, but didn't it? He goes, look, it wrecked me. He goes, but I came to the conclusion that I had 12 years with that beautiful boy, and I had 10 years with that beautiful boy, and I had 25 years with that beautiful woman. And he goes, no one could take that away from me because I have those memories. Because now I've got a new wife and I've got two more kids. And he goes, and I'm just focusing on what I have, not what I've lost. That was a very, very simple but very profound saying. You know what? Don't focus on what you've lost. Don't deny the pain and go through the grief. But focus on what you have, and that you will see your loved ones again when we get to heaven. And I think his faith helped him come through it. But I just thought this is so important for us to grasp, that we're to reign in life by viewing life from a totally different perspective. And the world needs this. When people face unbelievable trauma and grief, how do they cope? They don't cope. They need Jesus and need to focus on what they have, not what they don't have. I have the power, presence, and peace of God. I have the presence and power and peace of God. That's what the scripture says. Therefore, Paul says, be filled with the Spirit. Whenever you come together, come to church, sing, worship, lift your hands, praise. Speak and sing in your new prayer language, as Laura was leading us this morning. I don't know what you were doing. I'm at the front row. I'm just quietly praying in spirit, using my spiritual prayer language. We're entering in. I don't just want to have the power and presence and peace of God theoretically. Paul says, come on, now be on being filled with the Spirit. Enter into our Sunday worship experience by stepping out in faith and practically receiving through the Holy Spirit all that Jesus has made available for you. I have a healing covenant to draw from. Therefore, and pray in the Spirit on all occasions with all kinds of prayers and requests. With this in mind, be alert and always keep on praying for all the Lord's people. Take action. Ask for prayer, even today. Ask for prayer. Come forward for prayer, believing. Get two or three people to pray with you. Get them to anoint you with oil. Lay hands on you. I mean, you've heard Kathy's testimony of several weeks ago where she shared, I wasn't here for that Sunday, when she shared the story. I mean, she had a busted shoulder that required immediate surgery. I mean, it was really bad. It was one of the worst cases Adelaide's top soldier man shoulder specialist saw. And you could see all the breaks. Torn breaks. Ah, pain. No movement. What do we do? Well, from Ghana, we just say, you know what? Every time we have a worship service, Fida, I'm just going to lay hands on you, on that shoulder, and I'm going to pray in the Spirit. I'm just going to pray. And the image I had in my mind was touching the hem of Jesus' garment. That woman that just touched the hem of his garment. And she had a bleeding problem for 12 years. She went to doctors. No one could help her. The condition got worse. She lost all her money. She goes, if I can just touch the hem of his garment, I'll be made whole. That's what I've just been doing. So when she went to the doctor, and we have no feelings. We didn't feel any difference. And he goes, well, can you do something you haven't done? And she goes, boom, like this. 95% it came back. 9 out of 10 pain, now it was 1 out of 10. She's 95% there. Say 90%, let's be conservative. 90% there and maybe 1% pain. And I said to her, we've got a next appointment at the end of February. I said, we're going to still pray. So you may have noticed me today. I'm just laying hands on every time a worship service. I'm touching the hem of his garment. And all the pain go. The whole shoulder to be totally reconstructed. I want to see a new x-ray and all the bones fixed up. Isn't that something? Hey, do something. Do something with your belief about the healing covenant of God. Maybe a husband and wife, you need to pray once a week, take communion together, anoint each other with oil. Just believe, trust God, keep touching the hem of his garment. Step out. I have authority over all the power of Satan, and I am more than a conqueror through Christ. Oh, conquerors go and influence. Do you know, two of the nicest people you can ever meet would have to be Pastor Jim Varsos and his wife Jane. It was my privilege, actually. I've known Jimmy for 4 or 5 decades. So when we had the first revival in the high school, Jim was one of the younger kids, he's a few years younger than me, that made a commitment to Christ. And so he was part of our church here for many years, and he went with Pastor Bill Osborne up to Mount Barker. Nan, he became the pastor of the church at Nan. He's one of our pastors now in our Stirling CRC church. And Jim met Jane here, beautiful woman, and they've together have served the Lord. Jim has a story to tell. He's written up the story in The Me I Can Be in chapter 4. And you can read his story in the book. Jimmy, would you like to come and... share the story.
I'll take my glasses off. I can't see you. It's easier. Well, I guess I'll start just... I remember reading a story once of Mother Teresa. She was interviewed. And the interviewer asked her, you must pray a lot. And she says, no, I don't. I just listen. And the interviewer was a bit perplexed, and he asked her again, well, then what does God say when you listen? She says, nothing. He listens. And if you're going to ask me to explain that, I can't. I guess what I learnt as my story began was that God listens. He hears the cry and the pleas of the kids that cry out to him. And as we learn to grow in God and as we learn to trust him, he listens. He doesn't like the devil messing with his kids. He hates it. In fact, he gets angry at it to the point where he spilt blood for it. Some years ago, I suffered what was a fairly severe nervous breakdown. The details don't matter, but a rather renowned psychiatrist at the time said to me, "Jim, you'll never marry, you'll never have an education, you'll never have a job. You are destined to go from mental institution to mental institution for the rest of your natural life." I know he meant well. He wasn't successful. What got me in hospital was a little foolishness on my part. I dabbled with things I shouldn't have, and I met the spiritual side of the devil in ways that I perhaps did not want to, and it messed with me badly. But on that day when this psychiatrist told me what he told me, I began to hear the words that Pastor Bill Vassilakis would speak to me as a young boy accepting Jesus at Underdale High School in that music room. "For behold, I have given you power and authority to tread upon serpents and scorpions and over all the works of the devil. But do not rejoice that the demons are subject to you in my name, rather that your name is written in the book of life." And I guess those words began to well up in me, and I refused the notion of going into another mental institution, and the long journey home began. It was a hard journey, a long journey, and it actually required trust. I needed to trust than simply just believe the words. It's hard. I don't remember much of the time, and it doesn't matter what I do and don't remember, because the devil doesn't care what you believe. He only cares about what you act on. He's not interested in the things that you might espouse and philosophize, but what you act on, what you do. And I decided to do something. I'll tell you the remainder of it just in a couple of minutes, what happened with regards to the psychiatrist. But I do want to say this, that God, when he comes to people who are dealing particularly with mental illness, he doesn't minimize or trivialize your conditions. He didn't minimize or trivialize my condition, but he taught me who was master over them, and that was Jesus. And when I began to act on the words of Jesus, when I began to put them into play, other men in my world, Pastor Leo Harris, Pastor Ian Wood, Pastor Bill Osborne, who put up with me quite a lot. I don't know if you hear Bill, but you can talk to me later. I learned to trust these men. I learned to rely on these words when everything in my system said, "No, do it your way, have it your way." My victory was not only what God can do in my world, my victory was also dependent on what I was prepared to put down and what I was prepared to pick up. I was prepared to pick up the counsel and advice that these men over the 50 years, I'm nearly 60 now, but of my life that spoke into my world and put them into practice. It was a slow process. It didn't happen overnight. There's a story of two snails that climb up on the back of a tortoise, and one snail looked at the other and said, "Here we go." It doesn't happen quickly. It happens with time, patiently, quietly. As it turns out, I eventually applied for and got a position in the government and as an engineer. And in order to work for the government, you have to be careful that your marbles are intact. And I went for a psychiatric test. And the psychiatrist that examined me could not believe the diagnosis that I was given. In fact, I remember reading portion of his report. He said, maybe to his detriment, "Jim is probably one of the most sanest people I know." Well, if you know me, that's true. If you don't know me, take a chance. Which resulted in a 25-year stint working for the government. And that is another story. I would like to encourage anybody here today who is dealing perhaps with mental illness and the confusions that it creates. The devil is nothing but a bluff. He's just a noise. He's gone. It's over. It's defeated. It's finished. He's decaffeinated. Trust someone around you who is strong in the Lord. Give them the time of your day and learn over time, like the two snails and the tortoise, to put it into practice. Our victory is not something we gain. Our victory is something we have. We got it already. Thank you.
Well, thank you. Am I on? Yeah. Jimmy could talk for an hour. In fact, I said to him after the morning early service, he needs to write up his story and to put the details down, because to give hope and encouragement. And having known Jim for decades and walked with him, and to see that he has not just had a successful career in the government as an engineer, but a successful career as a pastor within our CRC movement, and being part of the answer to help people come to Christ and to provide healing for them. But his story is one of great hope and encouragement. And the battles that took place is a classic Joshua. You know, we possessed the land. We evicted the illegal trespassers, and we claimed the promises. And Jimmy came through those and received amazing healing and help. And not discounting the medical and counselling doorways, as Jimmy said, but it all goes hand in hand, working together for a person to be made whole. And I trust that his story will encourage you. In fact, it's more detailed in the book as he puts it in there. And I'm hoping that, Jim, that however many we are able to give away or sell, that people will read that and they'll ring here. We're trying to set up a web page because I want this to help people to say, who is that man? I want to talk to this Jim Vassos. I want to talk to Penny Hamble. We're able to actually put people through to them so that they can be helped, because that's the aim of it. It's a guide to help to overcome, how to gain victory. That's why I'm keen that when we make it available, get one, and get one to somebody who needs it. If I could give them all away, I'd do it, but we've got to cover the basic costs, so there's a slight cost to it. When I go overseas, I want to just give them to Papua New Guineans and others like that. But Jesus is real. He is alive. He is among us here today through the Holy Spirit. And as he has been speaking to you through his word and through testimony, let's receive from him today. Can we stand together?